If you want to prioritize security when browsing the web, the default settings in Chrome and other Chromium-based browsers are just not going to cut it. So in this video, I'm going to go over a bunch of settings and also hidden Chrome flags that you might want to change to maximize the security while browsing the web. Now, a lot of this is not going to protect you from yourself. For example, if you click a phishing site and it happens to not already be known, then you're just going to have to realize yourself that it's phishing. But for stuff like exploits and other stuff like that where it's not necessarily your fault that you get hacked, there's a lot you can actually do to improve the security there. So let's just get into it. First, I'll go over regular settings and then we can go over the flags. All of the ones I'm going to talk about can be found in the settings and then under privacy and security and then security. And even if you're using another browser like Edge or another Chromium-based browser, most of these should also be in there, maybe slightly called something different, but for the most part, they're going to be the same. The first biggest setting is the safe browsing mode. Now, by default, it's probably going to be standard, but I would recommend actually setting it to enhanced. That's what I use. And there is a privacy aspect. It does send every URL you visit to Google to analyze, but I mean, that is kind of necessary from the fact that it's going to analyze it. And it's different from the standard mode where my understanding is it might download a list of known malicious sites every several hours, if not once a day. And if you happen to visit a site that is known, but it didn't download that list yet, then you're not protected. Whereas in this case, it will always be the most up-to-date response. And this is really important because a lot of phishing and scam websites are very temporary. They spin them up and might only expect to last a few hours, and they have an automated thing that sets up a new one when it gets blocked. So waiting several hours between a block list update might be too late. Next, this is one that is more for privacy, and that is encrypted DNS. DNS is basically when your computer looks up the IP address associated with a domain that you type in. And usually, unlike a regular website where you visit it and the contents are encrypted, so your ISP can't see what's going on in there, the DNS request to look up the main domain is not usually encrypted, so they can kind of spy on that. But if you enable this, then it is. So mostly it's to prevent your ISP from spying on you. You probably won't notice any kind of difference, but there's not really a downside to it. You can choose one of the several providers. I like Cloudflare or NextDNS or really any of them. Or if you're some kind of tech expert who already has encrypted DNS set up at the operating system level, you can just have it use that. Now, the next setting I would recommend you enable is always use secure connections. This will make it so Chrome will always try to upgrade the connection from being insecure to secure if the option is there. And it will also give a more prominent warning on websites that don't support HTTPS encryption. Now, Chrome already by default will show you a big warning if a website tries to use encryption, but there's something wrong with the certificate, like it's expired or it doesn't match the website. It'll show a big warning about that. But by default, if it's a website that is not using any kind of encryption, then it just shows like a not secure thing at the top left. And you can still visit the site, of course. It just lets you know more obviously. Now, the next setting is going to sound more advanced, but it's actually pretty important. And it's going to be under Manage V8 Security. V8 is the JavaScript engine that Chrome uses. And I would very strongly consider setting the option to don't allow sites to use the V8 optimizer. Now, I'm not going to get into the technicals. If you want to look it up yourself, the V8 optimizer is referring to something called just-in-time compilation. But basically speaking, it allows scripts and stuff to run on websites faster, but there is a security trade-off. And apparently, according to Steve Gibson, who does security research and other stuff, over half the zero-day vulnerabilities that have been discovered are using just-in-time compilation and use this V8 optimizer thing. So disabling this potentially protects you from over half of the zero-day vulnerabilities where attackers find a way to attack and it is not patched before they start using it. So that is a major way to increase the security of your browser, especially for things where it's an exploit. It's not necessarily like you even do anything wrong. They just outsmart the browser, basically. Now, technically, there will be a performance hit, but I've had this enabled for a while and I have not noticed it. And if you do notice a site, for some reason, it seems to run really slow, or it's some kind of web app and a part of the site, it seems to run slow, you can actually just allow it on specific sites that you trust. So I would just keep it disabled. And then if you have to, you can enable it on individual sites. All right, now that we covered the regular settings, next we can go over the more hidden stuff with the Chrome flag settings. Before that though, like I touched on before, browser security settings are just one layer of security and still leave a lot of gaps, which is where today's sponsor comes in, Bitdefender, and their all-in-one security plan, Bitdefender Premium Security, which goes way beyond just browser protections within Chrome, even beyond enhanced safe browsing mode. Bitdefender Premium Security has web protection that scans all web traffic, not just your web browser traffic. So it can also block any other applications if they try to access a harmful link or IP address in the background without you knowing. It also has online scam protection through their Scam Copilot AI platform, including features like scam ad detection to block fake or malicious ads, blocking scam websites, and detecting new scam patterns. You even get protection for your mobile devices, where it can detect malicious links even when they appear in SMS messages, chat apps, calendar invites, or mobile app URLs. Plus, there's the Bitdefender anti-tracker browser extension to prevent, well, tracking. Of course, you still get Bitdefender's award-winning antivirus protections, which includes real-time protection to detect malware based on behavior, even if a particular malicious file hasn't been seen before. But there's a ton more that you get too, such as the Scam Copilot AI chatbot, which can analyze potential scam messages, links, situations, and more, and features like email protection, crypto mining protection, and a VPN. So if you care about security but don't want to worry about it, check out the link in the description to learn more about Bitdefender Premium Security. And with all that being said, let's continue. All right, so now we can move on to the more hidden Chrome flag settings. And you can access these by going to about:// flags, no matter what kind of browser you're in. And since most browsers are based on Chromium, most of these should be available in all of them. And what I'll do is first I'm gonna go over flags that you probably should just enable. I don't think there's a downside to it at all. And then we can go over ones that you might want to just consider and think about. All right, so as for the flags that I definitely think you should enable, the first one is going to be called Extensions Menu Access Control. And this shows a new, better menu when you click the extensions icon at the top right toolbar. Before, it would basically just group extensions by their current permissions, like full access, but it didn't really show much info up front, and I didn't think it was very clear. But with this new menu, it shows a lot more info, and it shows a clear toggle for which extensions have access on the current site, and then you can just toggle it off immediately, which will make it require you to click the extension for it to have access to a site. And you can see there's a more direct link to the access setting for that particular extension. So instead of the toggle, you can also use this menu to say access to all sites, just certain sites, or when I click it. Whereas before, you would have to navigate through like a bunch of dropdowns. It was really kind of annoying to get to. And also there's what I believe is a totally new option at the top of the menu to disable all extensions on a particular site, which was not possible before, I don't believe. So that could be useful in terms of security and practicality, because it might be a site that you don't want to risk any extensions having access to and using that info, but maybe a website is acting up and you're not sure if it's one of the extensions, then you can just toggle them all off and see if that makes a difference. All right, now the next flag is called Signature-Based Integrity Checks. This is more behind the scenes. It's not a feature you'll use, but it basically gives the option for web content and developers to require a certain type of verification for scripts and other stuff built into the website that might have to reference from some content delivery network or whatever. And I'm not going to get into any more of the technicals, but it probably is not going to be used very often right now because it's brand new, but there's not really a downside to enabling it because it only gets used if the server supports it and the web content specifically requests it. So it's not really a reason to not enable it. Next up, we have a flag called Client-Side Detection Brand and Intent for Scam Detection. And that is a real mouthful, but basically from my understanding is it uses a local AI to check a website for whether or not it's a scam, effectively. And then there's also an associated flag that you'd probably want to enable called Client-Side Detection Show Scam Verdict Warning. And I believe this makes it so it actually shows the thing. Now, I could not get this to actually trigger. I'm not 100% sure that it works yet, but you may as well enable it just for extra security for when it does become available. Or maybe I just didn't find a website that would trigger it. But again, it doesn't seem to be a downside to it. It just seems like it's an extra layer of protection, so you may as well. Okay, now this next feature is a lot easier to see the result of, and it's called local network access checks. And basically, it restricts websites from being able to access local devices on your network, which by default they can do, without you explicitly approving it. So for example, you might know how sometimes if you buy a router or other device, they might have a domain set up that you can go to and it helps you find the login page that's on your local network. Like one example is find.synology.com. It tells you, oh, here's the IP address and login for your NAS. Another one is Plex, where it's a domain that's an outside domain, but then if you visit it, it kind of redirects to wherever your server is locally. But you could potentially imagine how this could be used maliciously if a bad actor tries to go and probe maybe your default router IP address and access it, hoping that you're using the default password, something like that, and you don't want that to be possible. So with this setting enabled and you have to use the blocking option, what will happen is if, for example, I try to visit the Plex one, you can see that it asks you explicitly if you want to allow the website to redirect you and access to that location. And then if you allow it, it'll work like normal. And the same thing goes for Synology, though I did notice that it was still able to find the IP address of the device without prompting me or anything, but then it's only when I went to click connect and it actually tries to make some kind of connection that it prompted the thing. It actually showed a full screen thing and said like refresh to allow it. So it seems like the behavior is slightly different. So I'm not sure how it was able to get the IP address without connecting, but it seems like it still limits things, which is better than nothing. All right, now the next flag is another one more for privacy, and it's called enable noise for canvas readbacks in incognito. And I would actually just set this to enable in all browsing modes. You see, websites can use techniques called fingerprinting to analyze information about your browser itself to track you, even if you don't have cookies or anything like that, or you're using a VPN. And one of those is apparently the way your browser renders certain graphical elements can be unique, and they can track you based on that. Whereas this slightly randomizes certain properties or something. I don't fully understand, I'm not gonna pretend to, but it randomizes some things, so it's always gonna be different. Now, there's probably plenty of other ways they can track you, but it's just one less thing. And then finally, for the ones that I definitely think you should enable, is called bind cookies to their setting origins scheme. And basically what this does is if a cookie is given to the browser when you're connected to a site through HTTPS encrypted, from my understanding, it makes it so the site can then only use that cookie if it is connected still through HTTPS and not if it's not encrypted. And you can imagine how this kind of would be important, where if you're connected to a website securely and you properly log in and all that, and then for some reason you connect not securely and then you get a man-in-the-middle attack intercepting the connection, then they're going to be able to access that cookie. Whereas with this, it won't even send the cookie over the insecure connection. So to me, that seems kind of like a no-brainer. And now we can get into more advanced flags that you might want to look into. Either I wasn't really sure what it did, or there might be trade-offs, or they're not really well documented, but they're at least interesting. And this first one is very much related to the last one, sort of, and it's called bind cookies to their setting origins port. And the way this works is just like cookies are not bound to whether you're using HTTPS or not, apparently the port doesn't matter either by default. And you might think, well, what does that matter? And the thing to realize is you may have encountered cases where there are different web servers or pages on the same IP address or domain, but a different port. Like if you host a lot of local services on your own computer, you've seen this. They all have a different port, obviously, because it's just the same IP. It's your computer. So this makes it so the cookie is only associated with that exact port. Now, the reason I wouldn't definitely suggest enabling this, I don't know, is because I don't know how much this would break things. I don't know how often it is that a website needs to use a cookie that it assigned on a different port. So it might be worth testing out, but also be aware that it could mess up certain sites, but I have to imagine it'll be limited. But again, just be aware of it. Next up, this is another advanced one, and it's called Partition Alloc with Advanced Checks. Now, I'm not going to pretend like this one is also not way above my head. From my understanding, it has to do with memory allocation, and all I know is that a lot of exploits use memory exploits and buffer overflows and that sort of thing. I know that's a big problem in general, and that anything that improves that security is going to help. The only reason I didn't say you should definitely enable this one is because apparently there can be a performance hit. And unlike the V8 optimizer one, where it's clear that you do get a security benefit from it, I'm not really certain how often this actually would pay off. I did find a document that talked about how it could potentially be like a 20% hit if you enable it for all processes, which I think would be the one you want to use for all processes. So I personally enabled it, and I also ran a browser benchmark before and after enabling, and I didn't see a difference. So they might have optimized it since this description came out. So if you're someone who wants to prioritize security, you don't really care too much about the performance, or you won't notice, this is probably one to enable. Next up, we have a flag called Automatic Detection of WebUSB Compatible Devices. And actually, I set this to disabled. And that's because web browsers actually can access all your USB devices, from my understanding. And you don't necessarily want that. You want it to be able to access the human interface devices like your webcam, your keyboard, your YubiKey, fingerprint reader, stuff like that. But I don't necessarily want it to be able to access all the devices connected to my computer, which it normally can do. So from my understanding, disabling this just prevents it from doing that, and it still lets webcams and stuff work. I tested that, so you shouldn't have a problem there. So for the most part, I think this should only make a difference for specialty devices, and you lose the compatibility there, it might not work, who knows. Sort of related to this is another flag called Enable Isolated Web Apps to Bypass USB Restrictions. And I also personally set this to disabled. And I again checked to make sure that my webcam still works and microphone and all that. That all still works. So that's all I care about. I don't need anything personally bypassing restrictions, all right? So I wish they would kind of give a better description of what these were doing, but I'm gonna play it safe. You might choose to as well. Next up is a flag called Disable Subframe Process Reuse. And what this does is sort of like how Chrome will separate browser tabs into different processes so they're isolated. This, I believe, separates even subframes, like embedded websites within another website. It'll give it its own process. I believe that's what it does. So it's just more isolation. Might be a slight performance hit, just in the sense that it's creating more processes, which takes potentially more time to spin up, but should be more security, just having everything isolated. Moving on, this next one is also more for privacy. It's called Enable Fingerprinting Protection Blocklist in Regular Browsing. And what this does, kind of like I talked about before with fingerprinting by checking what resources your browser has, this just disables websites from being able to see certain stuff or simplifying it. And I believe that 3P is talking about third party. So it's like connections that are not even necessarily associated with the actual website you're on. The reason I'm not universally suggesting this is because I'm not really sure what resources it's talking about. There could be some websites that rely on something that it could be blocking because it's used for fingerprinting. I don't know, it's one where you'll just have to see if any websites you use get messed up by it, but otherwise you can probably just try it out. Very similar to the last one is another fingerprinting one called Reduce Accept Language Request Header in JavaScript Navigator Languages. And I enabled this one. That's just another thing that's used for fingerprinting. It has to do with which languages it tells the browser that you have. I believe it makes it so it only shows the current active language or something like that. And then finally, there's a flag called Deprecate the Unload Event, and I have this enabled. Apparently, it's some old JavaScript function that I read a blog post about it where it talks about how it's not even very reliable, and they're going to be deprecating it and removing it eventually anyway. And then they also talk about how disabling it could actually cause an increase in performance because it allows a faster alternative to be used that's built into Chrome. So you might choose to use that. Now, one more thing I want to point out, these flags change over time. So if you're watching this far in the future and you don't see one of these, then just be aware that they might've just removed it, or they might've just built it in and made it always on by default. So if you couldn't find one of these, don't worry about it. Now, I definitely want to hear what you guys think. Are you going to enable all of these, or maybe just some of them, or maybe none of them? You don't really care. Of course, if you enjoyed the video, be sure to give it a big giant thumbs up. It helps out. And if you want to subscribe, I try to make videos about twice a week, so it should be worth it. Thanks again to Bitdefender for sponsoring, and be sure to check out their all-in-one Bitdefender premium security plan through the link in the description. Now, if you want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is where I talked about the hidden good version of Google. It's a setting that you'll probably want to know about. I'll put that link right there you can click on. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.